Welcome back. You're watching Sunday Edition here on KTN News. I have with me political commentators Dismas Mokua and Hesbon Owila, Jubilee strategist Mutinda Kavemba, and Member of Parliament for Uriri Constituency, Mark Nyamita. We are discussing all matters, governance and politics. And very shortly, we shall be getting into the issue of the what happens now after the presidential petition last week. The six of the seven judges of the Supreme Court did give their detailed judgment, the four that had the majority vote and the dissenting views as well. Let's start there and listen to what they had to say. Remember, it was 12 hours of the six judges giving their full verdicts. Let's start with the majority views.
IBC to assault searching and to go back to the drawing board. If not, this court, wherever called upon to adjudicate on a similar dispute, will reach the same decision if the anomalies remain the same, irrespective of who the aspirants may be.
We find that the 2017 presidential election was not conducted in accordance with the principles laid down in the Constitution and the written law on elections. It was inter alia neither transparent nor verifiable. The second respondent declared the said results solely on the basis of Forms 34B, some of which were of dubious authenticity.
That the illegalities and the irregularities committed by the first respondent were of such a substantial nature that no court, properly applying its mind to the evidence and the law as well as the administrative arrangements put in place by IBC, can in good conscience declare that they do not matter.
So those are just two of the four of the judges on the majority vote. Gentlemen, we listened to these full judgments. Let me start with you, Dismas. Were you satisfied from the majority, from the four judges, from Maraga and Philomena Mwilu and Isaac Lenaola and Smokin Wanjala, for the reasons they gave for nullifying the results? We have seen there CJ saying no, from the illegalities, the illegalities committed were of such high caliber that no judge can, you know, like, not, you know, see them as serious. What is your take on the majority view? Were you satisfied?
Yes, and you know, Ben, there would have been two ways, either majority or the other way. And of course, unlike in most other judgments, we actually knew the outcome, so we were waiting for the explanations.
Yes.
And the explanations are very clear. As indicated earlier on, you do not need to be a lawyer or to have any legal qualification to understand that how they arrived at that, because, you know, they made so many determinations. But the things which really stood out is when the Supreme Court made an order that opened up the server.
Yes.
For some reason, IBC declined. And Justice Milu indicated that because they declined, they were forced to form the view that the system had been contaminated, it had been infiltrated, and it had been, you know, antagonized, and it needs to be sanitized. That's where the allegations of Davis Chirchir come from, that in fact he was able to access. And I guess now that's an issue which will be determined by the DPP when they do very serious investigation. And one wonders, if IBC really did a free, fair, and credible election, why were they reluctant? And you know, these orders were given by the Supreme Court. They were not given by a magistrate's court. While I know there's a contempt of court act, which doesn't make a difference between the Supreme Court or even the magistrate's court, but one wonders, if IBC did a free and fair election, why did they fail to deliver on that? And of course, you know, they spoke about the illegalities and irregularities that Mr. Kavemba admits, but it's very disturbing that Jubilee does not want to investigate those illegalities and irregularities, so that if President Kenyatta wins again, nobody compromises his victory for the second time. Mm-hmm. And again, I've seen a lot of criticism on Justice Njoki Ndungu and Jackson Ojuang because of the dissenting views they expressed. In a Supreme Court setting, it's expected that it must not be the case that all the judges must be of one view.
Yes.
You can dissent, you can be in the majority.
All right.
You can even offer a concurring opinion, which is okay. But what we must address, Ben, as a nation, when we want to make progress, we must give the Supreme Court judges the opportunity to take decisions without having to check out or maybe on the fear of the consequences. Because right now I know a number of judges in the Supreme Court are beginning to wonder. You know, in the past we were told choices have consequences. I think now some of their decisions are going to have consequences.
All right.
Because when you start intimidating these judges because of their decision or independence, it's unacceptable. And you know, there's been a lot of stories, there's been a lot of social media work, some allegations on the Wakora network. You are bringing into disrepute the reputations of highly regarded judges. If you do not like the judgment, please go to the merits and demerits of the case. Attack that judgment viciously instead of attacking the personality.
I want us to talk about what this petition did and what happens moving forward. But Hesbon, what was your reaction to that, to the detailed judgments?
I think the detailed judgment made it clear that it was not so much about the numbers as it was about the processes and the fact that, again, IEBC did not really make it easy for them to understand the long haul of the process up to the server. Actually tilted, you know, was a clincher for the petitioner in the sense that you look at the arguments that they were presenting, they were more or less talking about the process. And you look at the arguments that the first and the third respondent were advancing, it was a question of numbers. So they went on about numbers. And it was not very clear how the judgment would come out, but it is now clear after the judgment that the whole question was about the process, that you cannot talk about a product whose acquisition was through a flawed process. And I think going forward, it is basically speaking to, you know, future elections, beginning with the presidential elections on 26th of October, that the focus that IBC needs to attend to is how do they ensure that they have a process that is free, fair and credible, and most importantly, how do they have proper documentation that then will help anyone who wants to verify the election and the processes that tenured whoever is going to win, do that with clarity of mind. So much so that if ultimately either President Uhuru Kenyatta or Raila Odinga is declared, whoever loses will go home in honor knowing that I lost because the product was a product of a process that each and every Kenyan understands to be very free and fair. But I think, again, most importantly is the fact that the judgment, in as much as it talked about the illegalities and irregularities,
yes,
exposed itself to some extent, because there are critics who are asking, if there were illegalities and irregularities, how comes there are no people who are involved in this? You know, so there is a sense in which you may want to ask yourself, is it that they deliberately decided to talk about this without pointing fingers at individuals who are responsible, mm-hmm, or they now delegated that to the relevant, you know, agencies of the government, including the DPP.
All right.
Ben, there's something curious that maybe Mr. Kavemba would advise us, that Jubilee is coming up with proposals to amend sections of the Constitution. And one of those is to amend the way the Supreme Court is going to be structured. That if you want to reverse a decision about the election of a president, you at least need five judges. And you know, we've got seven judges at the Supreme Court, and either five or seven forms at the quorum to take a decision. So it's a very curious, and maybe we need to be educated on the merits and demerits of having a constitutional provision telling the Supreme Court on how they're supposed to be taking the decision. Because all over the world, the best practice is that it's always the majority.
Simple majority.
Because now, if you say that you need five judges to review that kind of a decision, what happens if you don't have the two judges and a decision needs to be reviewed? That's very curious. And the second issue that Mr. Wheeler has raised, the Supreme Court was not acting when they were looking at this petition. It was sitting in its capacity as an election court. It was not a criminal court. Criminal matters are being referred now to the DPP to get his evidence and prosecute further. For one reason, that if the Supreme Court would have pronounced themselves that particular persons are guilty, then the DPP would have no business doing any investigation. These guys would not be presented in any other court. They would be sentenced.
All right. Well, Tinda, the third respondent was found.
There are statements that we should not leave unchallenged, like one that Dismas made, that Jubilee is not willing to investigate and prosecute the culprit in IBC. Of course, that is a factually wrong statement, because first, Jubilee as a political party.
Supporting investigation to sanitize the entire process.
We need to understand the framework of our constitution. The DPP is the person who can determine who's going to be charged or not. There are bodies that should investigate. It's already written to them. So when you say Jubilee does not want, who exactly do you want to do that job? If not the people who already started doing the job. No, this is about the law. The DPP has already written to the ESCC and to the DCI. So who else in Jubilee do you want to take up this job, if not those offices are constitutionally
mandated?
So that's why I was saying, so you cannot state or purport that Jubilee is not interested when these actions have already been taken. That was the first point. I was just responding to a point that he made. Then now we come to the issue of the ruling and the judgment. As Jubilee, you know, we are in agreement with the two that were dissenting. And our argument is similar to their argument.
Yes.
And that is for you to understand where we are coming from when people are calling for the...
Speaking of which, let me just interrupt you. Just hold that thought, Mutinda.
Yes.
Let's listen into the two dissenting views from last week's detailed judgment. That is Lady Justice Joaquin Ndungu and Justice Professor Jackton Ojwang.
Election causes ought to be determined in the light of the highest consideration of the right of the electorate to vote in a free and fair election. This court must never abdicate its duty as an election court, exercising exclusive original jurisdiction to hear and determine disputes relating to elections arising under Article 140. As an election court, the court must not narrow its scope of its remedies or delegate its powers to the parties. The zeal of the voter to participate in elections and the overwhelming responsibility of every stakeholder to conduct free and fair elections must be matched by equal zeal from this court. The majority nullified the conduct of the presidential election solely on the basis that some forms 34A and 34B lacked security features, which are elected by the commission and spread in different versions across most forms. The majority in the aftermath of the registrar's report did not attempt to peruse the enormous evidence deposited by the first and second respondents bearing certified copies of Form 34A, Form 34B, of the and check, and against which they ought to have checked the alleged irregularities. By subjecting the integrity of the election to considerations of design that are neither statutory or regulatory, the majority has not only threatened the people's belief in the electoral system, it has overburdened and in fact negated the electorate's right to franchise.
In my view, that the majority on the instant petition has made a precarious move that is destined to prove detrimental to the dependable setting of relations among essential governance entities, to the detriment of the rights and legitimate expectations of the citizen. What the majority has said is set out, and you have already seen it, and they have made their orders in a manner that you know. Such a determination is in clear departure, in the first place, from the state of the evidence. As already indicated herein, the petitioner's case rests on just one dimension of the electoral process, electronic transmission of results. Moreover, the bulk of the assertions made as regards transmission is just that, contentions with only limited testimonial ingredient. It is hardly evidence, what Black's Law Dictionary calls something including testimony, documents, tangible objects, that tends to prove or disprove the existence of an alleged fact. That is evidence which we have been looking, I'm looking for.
Excerpts from the two dissenting, the judges that dissenting views. Mutinda, you are explaining to us your
I wanted to explain to you. I think you've been hearing a call about taking the boxes, ballot boxes to Kasarani and open it up. That I want to explain where that thinking is coming from, and of course it is buttressed by the thinking of the dissenting judges, that the election took place, that there was legitimate expectation from the electorate. We all queued from very early in the morning and up to evening, and what we were expecting is for us to be told what have we said in that. Now, it is alleged, and actually, like Justice Ojwang said, that solely on the issue of, from that point of the polling station to the tallying center, it is alleged, and according to him, the evidence threshold of proving that was not even met, that whatever was, it cannot be ascertained that whatever was taken to the bombers is what came from the polling station. So as Jubilee, we've been wondering and asking ourselves, why did the court not find it wise and prudent to go back to that point where there was no contest before the issue of transmission and established what exactly had the people said? Because all these technicalities that were used are things that came up after the citizenry had already exercised their mandate and right to vote. So why then have they been pulled in and are being punished mm-hmm. for mistakes that were done by someone else, and that probably, even if assuming that they were done, there was a way of remedying them by going back to the process before we start even that transmission?
So
I'm trying to say the thinking of most of the Jubilee membership, and that is supported by the dissenting judges.
Right.
Yes.
What my friend is actually forgetting here is one, and I've listened to, I've also read the dissenting opinions of the two judges. One, I want to say, I'm not a lawyer, but I want to say that I think the two dissenting judges in this particular case went actually off tangent. They failed to address the case as presented by the petitioner and only waited for their colleagues to write their judgment. Then they are dissenting on the actual judgment of the petitioner. Because the bulk of the 440 pages and the 190 pages written by the two dissenting judges is actually criticizing their colleagues, saying, oh, my colleague didn't do this, my colleague didn't do this. The four judges did not present the petition. So I think actually they took a different tangent. Number two, you will remember in this very, very court, and we all watched it live, the petition, the IBC and the third respondents, the first, second, and third respondent, were unable to explain the difference in numbers. So when we talk about these numbers, that numbers don't matter. They were asked, how is it possible that over 500,000 people were only voting for the president and not voting for the other positions? And they failed to actually talk about. So when these people talk about particular numbers that, you know, and you hear there Justice Ojwang, with all due respect, you know, I know him, with all due respect, saying that there was no contention in terms of the numbers. There was. We had there, they were talking, there was a big dispute about 500,000 plus numbers of people who only went in and voted for the president and they didn't vote. So even as my friends here are saying, oh, bring in the ballot boxes, we want to know, even before opening the boxes, who are these 500 people who went with 6 ballot papers, voted for the president and took the other 5 ballot papers and went out with them? So when they talk about numbers, the numbers are actually in contention. But back to Jubilee narrative that, you know, numbers matter, processes don't, is not anything new. You will know that it's what we call the hustler mentality. The hustler mentality is that, you know, the end justifies the means. That it is not anything new in this particular government, you know, that today I can own half of Kenya. It doesn't matter, I own it. Forget about how we actually got here. And one of the judges, and I think is the DCJ, Justice Mwilu, particularly said that even when you're doing a mathematical sum, some of us who went through the maths classes, you cannot reach an answer without enumerating how you have actually arrived at it, unless you actually looked at your neighbors and saw the final answer as 42, and you just wrote 42 without actually going through the process. But again, you would not blame my Jubilee right. colleagues, because, you know, they are used to it, you know, they are just, you know, the end justifies the means. You know, it's a hustler mentality, and this is what we're saying must end.
All right. Utinda, do you agree?
You know, I'm wondering what he's saying, and when we are asking for a recount, what exactly then do we want to establish? So
do you remember,
we are told, for instance...
No, Mutinda, just sorry.
Yes.
Do you remember, at some point during the presentations of the Supreme Court, we even talked about a recount, and there was even an adjournment during the court process. And both, maybe he's not aware, the lawyers for the respondents, including the third respondent, retreated. The court took a one-hour break to actually discuss whether we would go for a recount. Mwite, senior counsel Mwite, refuted Ngatia, who was for the third respondent, refuted about that we should not go back to recount. Today, they want us to go back to recount when they have been the custodians of the ballot boxes. Right. We are saying no. So you refused it in the first place.
It was not one of the
prayers. Because of the overwhelming belief that we voted and our numbers were more than those of NASA. That is what is becoming very difficult for Jubilee.
But you refused for us to go.
And you can
understand. You refused for us to go for a recount in the petition during when the case was actually being conversed in the Supreme Court.
You can't say that, and it was clearly that none of your prayers was about a recount. We know what your prayers were.
We didn't ask for a recount.
Don't use that.
If you are sure of your numbers,
and you know the law as it is now allows, and I know you know that because you're an honorable member of parliament,
yes.
That for instance, if in Uriri, a petitioner goes to court,
yes.
And he or she feels that their numbers were more than yours,
yes.
One of their prayers, other than recount, is that once the recount establishes that they won, we don't go back for a by-election, but the court declares them the winner. Are we in agreement that there is that provision?
The reason why
that the court can declare you a winner once they establish that you actually won?
The reason why we did not go ask for a recount, one, is because
numbers even not
from
favorable.
Even from the onset, there was 500,000 people who voted for the president and did not vote.
We would even have ascertained the distribution of that 500.
All right.
To know whether they were in NASA regions or in Jubilee regions, it would have helped us know clearly who is guilty of what.
Ben, I think there's
because
one
we told
thing,
you the 500,000 yes. might not have come
there's
from
There's one thing that probably from just a neutral observer like I would use to dispute the issue of recounting the ballots, even today. In the ruling, it was made clear that there were close to 600 plus polling stations that were either non-existent, not gazetted, fictitious, or wherever. So to the extent that people voted from these polling stations, maybe tells you that maybe there were ballot boxes that either NASA or Jubilee did not know about, and you can't ascertain who it was favoring. And therefore, if you talk of recount, you also need to be alive to the fact that you could actually be recounting including ballot papers that were part and parcel of a flawed process.
Right.
So the issue of recount, I think, does not exonerate either Jubilee or NASA.
Right.
But then, I think Jubilee,
what he has said
Mutinda,
can be handled
my friend
very...
has been a councillor here in Nairobi. And let me give you an example. This comes to mind very close. Unity Primary School,
yes.
Which has about 658 registered voters in one of the polling booths.
Both, yes.
658.
Yes.
When I remember in the case, and you can actually go and refer, when the presidential results were actually announced, Raila obtained about 220 plus. Uhuru was reported to have got 1,200 in that particular polling center. I remember because when we were at Jacaranda, we actually went with it and tried to find out how is it possible.
All right. Let's leave it there, gentlemen. We are legislating on a case that has already been done and dusted. Let's leave it there. I mean, there's a lot to discuss. There's a lot to agree and disagree about. When we return after this quick commercial break, we'll talk about what happens now after the petition. Both sides of the political divide have had their say on how the petition was, on the verdict, on the detailed judgment by the six judges of the Supreme Court. When we come back, we'll talk about what happens. Is this, as has been lauded by some pundits, as one of the best judicial decisions ever on this continent, or is it, like Jubilee is claiming, to be a judicial coup? Let's talk about that next.